let's get started. So, Campus Science 101, aka the best class ever. aka, this is all we do in this course room. It's a little different. You guys are seated today wearing gold clothes. But on more of a serious subject, we're today going to be diving, I'm going to give you a good overview of the science of Campus. And this is actually the cover of Time magazine 2 years ago. And yes, in case you were wondering, I do spend a lot of my time trying to figure out how to teach mice to use little lighters. You don't have a thumb. How do you flick the thing? Also, where do you find these tiny lighters? I don't have the answer. Warehouse, the store of everything. They don't have tiny mouse lighters, though. Come on. All right. So, but all seriousness, today we're going to cover a few big topics. So number one. You know, you in this room, all your bodies make cannabinoids. These molecules are very similar to the compounds made by the cannabis plant. We only discovered this recently. We're also going to talk about the fact that cannabis is not harmless. There are significant risks and harms that we should be aware of to have a rational conversation. There is also immense medical potential that Brendan alluded to some of it, as well as there are massive barriers to research that are preventing us from realizing this potential. Okay, so our story today starts 600 million years ago. Okay, and so you might be thinking, what the heck was going on 600 million years ago? And so if you're anything like my nephew, the first thing that you might blurt out of your mouth is dinosaurs. See, he loves dinosaurs, right? You ask him, like, what'd you do in school today, dinosaurs? What'd you learn today, dinosaurs? I'm like, are you learning that every day, or are they teaching you math, science? It's weird. But you would be incorrect, because you know, dinosaurs were about 100 to 200 million years ago. We're talking much, much, much older than the dinosaurs. So 600 million years ago is when we believe endocannabinoids first developed in multicellular life. Okay, and so these are signals. These are messenger molecules. So to give you an analogy, if you have, let's say you have ignition keyhole to an engine. Okay, that's something we call a receptor. In living organisms. And you have messenger molecules, such as endocannabinoids, that are the key to that receptor. And so if you have the right signal, the right key, it'll fit in that keyhole and be able to turn on the engine. And once the engine is on, all of these things will happen in the cell. Okay, and that's actually a very good analogy. It's truly a key and keyhole analogy, like physically on a molecular level, that's how they're interacting to unlock and transmit the signal into all of these cellular processes. And so endocannabinoids, endo meaning internal, cannabinoid meaning cannabis-like. And we only discovered this system about 25 years ago. And when we discovered this system, at first we didn't call it anything, right? It's like, here's some interesting molecules, these interesting messengers and receptors that we found. And then we realized that things like THC were also impacting the same receptors. So THC and endocannabinoids are acting on the same receptors. So in a way, THC is actually mimicking the endocannabinoids that our bodies naturally make. And this system, you might first just think that, okay, you know, the effects of cannabis, maybe it's just limited to your brain. Well, it's very concentrated. So this is the density of receptors, of endocannabinoid receptors, right? Keyholes all over your body. They are concentrated in your brain, but you can also find that they're all throughout your body. They're in your fat, they're in your bone, they're in your muscle tissue. They're on your white blood cells, they're on your skin cells, they're in your organs, they're everywhere throughout your body. And then if you look at the functions of the endocannabinoid system, it's also diverse. And so some of these functions it might make a lot of sense if you're familiar with the effects of cannabis. You might look at things like the effects of the endocannabinoid system on appetite or pain, for example. But there's other ones that you might not expect as much, that the endocannabinoid system is implicated in metabolism and immune function. That kind of explains some of the effects that we see of cannabinoids on some of these mouse studies, and I'll talk more about that later. All right, so 600 million years ago, evolution of the endocannabinoid system. 100 million years ago, dinosaurs went extinct. And today, we still find that the endocannabinoid system is actually present in all of these animals. Basically, anything that has a vertebra makes endocannabinoids. Everything from frogs to mice to fish to us, we all make endocannabinoids because this is such an old, evolutionarily preserved system. And about 40 million years ago, that's when we believe the cannabis plant evolved. And this plant happened to make things called cannabinoids. It made things like THC, tetrahydrocannabinol, and things like CBD. cannabis dial. So before today's lecture, who here in the room has actually heard of CBD? Show of hands. Wow, that's almost everybody. 3 years ago, if I'd asked that question, 0 to 1 hands might have gone up in this room. That's how quickly CBD has hit mainstream attention, driven initially by the parents of epileptic children who were reporting use of it. But those are just two cannabinoids. There are over 100 different cannabinoids in cannabis, vast majority of which have never been researched. They've never been put into an animal or human to see what happens there. And we'll talk more about this later. So, 40 million years ago, cannabis evolves. It's making these cannabinoids, and these cannabinoids, again, are mimicking the endocannabinoids that we make, right? They are both THC and our endocannabinoids are similar-looking keys that open the same keyhole that start all of these downstream cellular processes. Okay. And you might be surprised to know that if there's a way that we could actually impact endocannabinoid system activity, we could potentially be impacting nearly, or many, if not almost all, diseases that affect humans. So this is actually a review paper out of the US NIH, which is the federal government's biomedical research arm, where they went through all the literature that we know about how the endocannabinoid system is implicated in both health as well as disease. And we're finding that if there's some way that we could impact the endocannabinoid system, we could have therapeutic potential amongst all diseases affecting humans. And cannabinoids are a modulator of endocannabinoid system activity. They're not the only modulator. Diet, exercise, other drugs also modulate the endocannabinoid system activity. But cannabinoids are one very important modulator that we should be aware of. Okay, so 40 million years ago, cannabis evolves. Now we jump to about 3,000 years ago when we have the first recorded written uses concerning cannabis consumption for medical use or for spiritual recreational use. We were using cannabis maybe about 10,000 years ago, but mainly it was for fiber and industrial hemp purposes. It was really 3,000 years ago in China that we had the first recorded medical uses. And so this is this mythical emperor, Chen Ming, who has been accredited with authoring these materials. And this is the Chinese character for ma, which means both cannabis as well as anesthesia in China. And that character has been preserved for a really long time. And so, you know, you might be wondering, so Emperor Chen Ming and some of his officials asked him, you know, Emperor, how is it that you discovered these properties? He went, well, you know, I smoked it, but I didn't inhale, so just... Alright, so, 3,000 years ago, it's discovered in China, and we see, we can actually document in written text the spread of the medical use of cannabis to the Middle East, where it's adopted by Persians and the Indian Hindus. It's adopted by the Romans and the Greeks. It makes its way to medieval Europe, and then eventually gets its way over to the U.S., where about 150 years ago, it's officially entered into the U.S. pharmacopoeia. And this is the official book, the standard-setting document that describes all recognized medicines. And in the pharmacopoeia in 1850, cannabis is listed as having all of these use cases, some of which were probably a little hokey and misinformed, but there's a few that I want to draw your attention to. And it's because if you look at the national conversation today, the surge in recent interest, as well as the emerging science, these are some areas that only today we're finally diving into the science of and having a conversation about, but we were already widely using and recognizing the use for these indications 150 years ago. And you also might be surprised to know that even as late as 100 years ago, physicians in America would prescribe cannabis. You would go to the pharmacy, you'd pick up a cannabis tincture bottle, similar to, you know, the tinctures being made by, for instance, Tilray in Canada. And some of today's existing largest pharmaceutical companies manufactured cannabis tinctures 100 years ago. You go to a pharmacy and pick it up. This was completely normal. And in fact, the American Medical Association actually went to Congress and tried to prevent the restrictions on cannabis that happened in the 1930s, saying that this is medicine that we use, why are we doing this? Okay, so now let's talk a bit, we'll talk about the history. Now let's actually dive into what's actually in the plant, what's under the hood. So, like I said, cannabis makes cannabinoids, right? And there are over 100 different cannabinoids. The two most abundant ones are THC and CBD in a really simple way. You can create a dichotomy, one's psychoactive, one's not. But I'll try to differentiate properties more. But again, there's over 100 different cannabinoids. These two just tend to be the most abundant in most varieties of cannabis that we see today. But just because you have a specific cannabinoid that is present in very small quantities doesn't mean that it doesn't have a physiologic impact. So if you look at, in pharmacology, if you look at the dosing spectrum of drugs, it can go from milligrams of a drug to have a physiologic effect all the way to grams. So that's a thousandfold on this scale. So just because something is in low concentration, you know, it might be 1/100th the concentration of THC in a particular cannabis plant, doesn't mean that it doesn't have physiologic effect. But again, we most of these have never been studied. So let's talk about THC. So it's responsible for this shift in perception that you have when you're intoxicated. It can change your perception of sound, taste, smell, those things. It does stimulate appetite. It also releases dopamine, which can cause the euphoria related to cannabis, and we believe that this is playing a role in the kind of abuse dependence aspect that can result from cannabis use. Short-term, it can also impair memory. So while you're acutely stoned, you will have deficits in certain forms of memory during that period of time. And impairment in motor coordination. So what does that mean? It means you have about a doubling of your risk of car accidents. But you compare that with alcohol, when you're over the legal limit of alcohol, it's significantly higher, 6 to 8x. And if you start looking at texting while driving, it jumps even higher than that. So contrast that with CBD. Very, very different things we're talking about. So first off, it's non-psychoactive. It doesn't have any effects, as we can tell, on motor coordination. No euphoria, that's why we don't think that there's much of a dependency or addictive potential to CBD. Does not stimulate appetite. In fact, in some of these animal studies, it looked like it might even slightly curb appetite in some of these animal studies. And also, if you combine it with THC, there's some evidence to suggest that it might actually block the psychoactivity of THC. So very different molecules. And the other interesting thing about CBD is, so THC definitely does have therapeutic potential. CBD might have a wider range of therapeutic potentials, evidenced by this quote. So this is from Dr. Volkow. About 2 years ago, she was testifying in Congress. She's the director of the U.S. National Institute on Drug Abuse. So she is the federal research arm for studying the abuse potential of drugs. And in testifying in front of Congress, she basically talks about how there's preliminary evidence, animal studies, showing that CBD has anti-seizure properties, that it's an antioxidant, like resveratrol from wine. It has neuroprotective properties, its ability to prevent death in neurons, anti-inflammatory properties, analgesic properties, like anti-pain, anti-tumor, actually killing cancer cells, slowing their growth, preventing their spread, antipsychotic properties that have recently been demonstrated in the first human trials in the last few years in schizophrenics, and working as we see it, as well as some of our conventionally used antipsychotic drugs, and anti-anxiety properties. So this is pretty fascinating, but again, all very preliminary. Most of this information is stuck at the animal stage. Very little of it has progressed in humans. Okay, so we talked about the cannabinoids being present in cannabis, but there's also things called terpenes. So who here in this room, before Brendan's talk, has heard of terpenes before? Again, a few years ago, when I asked, it would have been significantly less. So terpenes, anytime you smell a plant and you smell something, you're smelling a terpene. And these are not unique to cannabis, but they are particularly diverse in cannabis. Over 100, and maybe as much as over 200 different terpenes have been identified to be expressed by different strains of cannabis. So this is one example of a terpene. It's present in lavender, linalool. It's also present in cannabis, and it has anti-anxiety and some anti-pain properties in preliminary studies. So we're talking about cannabinoids. We're talking about terpenes. There's hundreds of compounds floating around, and that naturally leads to a discussion of the entourage effect. And it's this hypothesis that the combination and the synergistic activity of all of these different compounds is superior to that of any individual cannabinoid. than just THC by itself or just CBD by itself. And again, there's some preliminary evidence to suggest this. So for instance, when you administer a whole plant cannabis extract and administer an identical amount of just CBD, for example, you see different physiologic responses in the animals that are tested. But it's still a hypothesis, right? But this is something that if you talk to people in the cannabis industry, that this will come up again and again and again. And that leads me to this point. So there actually are approved cannabinoids throughout the world. So for instance, Marinol, here on the left, that is synthetic THC. It's THC created in lab, put in a pill. That's been FDA approved for 30 years, more than 30 years. And whereas cannabis is a Schedule I drug, cocaine and meth are Schedule II, THC is a Schedule IV drug when administered as Marinol. And then you have preparations of Sativex, which is approved throughout the EU, and it's literally cannabis extract. They grow cannabis in the UK, and they extract out the cannabinoids and make this medicine, and it's approved throughout the EU. And Epidiolex is undergoing FDA approval right now in the US. All right, now the other thing that you might hear is all these miraculous stories about cannabis, right? It cured my mom's ex. My neighbor's dog had a wart and then got put cannabis oil on it and went away. Right, and you might start, and there's some people that you talk to that think this is some miracle, miraculous, panacea drug. And I caution all of you to take all of that with a grain of salt, right? And so whenever someone comes up to you and opens with, hey, I read a story that cannabis does blank, I want you to be super skeptical, like this skeptical chihuahua, right? So as soon as they start talking, I want you to squint your left eye and bug out your right eye, right? And so we have to take all this with a grain of salt, and a lot of it we probably have to toss out, but not all of it, right? There's definitely some kernels of truth there. In fact, before we had rigorous placebo-blinded controlled trials, which have only been around for less than 100 years, everything that humans knew about anything was from pattern recognition. As creatures, we are very good at pattern recognition as a species. That's why we've been able to advance so far. So again, eventually you see something long enough, there's a pattern that arises. And sometimes it's worth it to kind of chase after some of these patterns or anecdotes that we see. All right, so let's talk a little bit about the harms as well. And there are significant ones we should be aware of. So let's start with some deaths of Americans each year caused by some other common drugs or substances in society. So tobacco still, we talk about the opioid epidemic, but tobacco is still killing about 500,000 Americans a year. And NSAIDs, things like aspirin, ibuprofen, Aleve, Advil, Motrin, kills about 10,000 Americans a year. And so then compare that number for cannabis, and it's near zero. And the reason I put the question mark is there's probably some traffic accidents where someone's stoned and they kill themselves. But if you talk about direct toxicity, direct overdose of cannabis, it's pretty much close to zero. We don't have really any documented cases ever compared to 10,000 a year dying from non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like aspirin, ibuprofen. Okay. But I don't mean to gloss the harms over, because there's a very significant risk that nobody's talking about. Media isn't talking about. I want you to look at this number. 440,000. These are the amounts of lives of Cheetos every minute that die as a result. It's a travesty. It's an epidemic. And nobody's doing anything to prevent Cheetos from the harms of cannabis. But on all seriousness, there are some significant harms we need to be aware of. So for instance, it appears that in individuals that are genetically predisposed to schizophrenia, using cannabis early on in life will increase the odds that they actually do develop schizophrenia. Women who are pregnant and use cannabis during pregnancy give birth to babies with lower birth weight. Adolescents that begin heavy cannabis use during their adolescence, we see there's an association with lower socioeconomic achievement later in life, lower educational attainment. Then there's the issue of dependency and abuse. So some people will say cannabis is not addictive, and that's just frankly not true. A widely cited study shows that about 10% of people who try cannabis once will at some point in their life go on to be dependent on it. Okay, it's 10%, that's not zero, it's 10%. So you have to compare that with alcohol, which is about 15%, and nicotine, 32%, one of the most addictive substances known to man. Okay, so it's not, there is addictive potential. Statistically, it might be lower than that of other substances, but it's non-zero. Also, cannabis withdrawal, it's a real thing, 100%. You can have physical symptoms of withdrawal. Not everybody gets it. Not everyone experiences it. We're not exactly sure why. But it is a real thing. And for some people, when they're trying to quit cannabis use, and they stop, and they feel they get restless, they have no appetite, they have no energy, they can't sleep at night, that can perpetuate the dependency cycle, and they go back on it. And then if you're whispering to your friend, no, you can't have withdrawal from cannabis, what are you talking about? Then you're just making it even harder for them to get help that they need. What about the effects of cannabis on cognition or memory? So in adults, in chronic cannabis users, in adults, there's some studies that show a mild decrease in certain forms of memory. But this appears to be temporary, because when you go abstinent, within about 30 days, those mild deficits in memory correct. Okay. And the last issue, lung cancer, right? We find no association between cannabis use and lung cancer, even heavy, heavy daily use for decades, no association with this lung cancer. All right, so let's wrap this up talking a little bit about what I see coming down the pipeline in terms of the therapeutic potential as well as the globalization. So Brendan talked a lot about this, but yeah, the spread of medical cannabis around the world, right? So now the US is the only country in North America sandwiched between Canada and Mexico that does not have nationally legal medical cannabis. But and this trend is going to continue as more and more countries legalize medical cannabis. In terms of some of the most interesting use cases for cannabis, I'm just going to focus on three today for the sake of time. So this whole issue of it being a potential opioid substitute, right? So first off, we know that cannabinoids are effective for chronic pain. Okay. Number two, there are preliminary studies that show that these opioid-sparing properties of cannabinoids, when you combine cannabinoids with opioids, you can reduce the opioid dose up to 10 times and still achieve the same amount of pain relief. Right? So you need this much opioids to achieve pain relief. If you drop it as much as 10x and add a little bit of cannabinoids, you can achieve that same amount of pain relief. We see epidemiologically there's an association between states that legalize medical cannabis and lower opioid overdoses. And the last part is we know cannabinoids can reduce neuroinflammation. And we believe that neuroinflammation is also implicated as a component in both chronic pain as well as opioid dependence. So the ability of cannabinoids to treat the pain itself, to work synergistically with the opioids, as well as to reduce the neuroinflammation that might be exacerbating the pain. Then there's the anti-tumor properties of cannabis that were alluded to in that Dr. Nora Volkow's quote. So we do see in animal studies across many, many different types of cancers, there's tons of different cancer sites, some have been tested with cannabinoids. So both THC and CBD, as well as some other cannabinoids, can actually cause these cancer cells to self-destruct. They can also prevent the growth of blood vessels that go and feed the tumor, as well as preventing the tumor from spreading. Again, very preliminary, but they just did the first human study of this for brain cancer, glioblastoma multiforme, the first exploratory trial of this in humans. So we are starting to embark on the human studies. The best part is it's not toxic to normal cells. So chemotherapy, many chemotherapy agents, they're a shotgun approach. Yes, they kill a cancer cell, but in the process, they're killing any cells that are rapidly growing. The lining of your stomach, your hair, things of that nature. And the last part is, you know, cancer patients have a lot of symptoms that cannabinoids might have therapeutic potential for. And so now you talk about one compound that could be treating, you know, a whole wide array of symptoms and potentially for certain cancers might be slowing the growth and treating that aspect. So now you're talking about rather than having to take six drugs, each of which has their own side effects. Then you talk about the cost of it. You talk about drug-drug interactions. So each drug has its own side effects. Then you have drug-drug interactions, which cause another level order of side effects. Cannabinoids are also neuroprotectants. So this is actually a patent entitled Cannabinoids as Antioxidants and Neuroprotectants. And this patent is actually owned by the US federal government. And it's old, it's from 2003. And it's from research that was done at the NIH on cannabinoids. And if you read the body of the patent, it talks about how cannabinoids have been found to be useful in age-related diseases, inflammatory diseases, autoimmune diseases like lupus, Crohn's, neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's. Right? And as our baby boomers are massively expanding the amount of senior citizens in this country, the next epidemic that's going to come is an epidemic of neurodegeneration. Right? Age is one of the biggest risk factors for things like Alzheimer's or Parkinson's. Okay, so that brings me to this last point. So if I were to ask you, what is the most popular herb in America, right? And I wasn't giving you a talk on cannabis. You might think, oh, it's, you know, ginkgo, echinacea, turmeric, right? And the market size of those herbs is on the order of hundreds of millions of dollars a year in sales. Whereas we're talking about the market size of cannabis in America, it's tens of billions, right? So 100 times larger than the second most popular herb in America. So cannabis is America's most popular herb. And that leads me to some other, you know, observations that people have had about cannabis as a therapeutic agent, right? So the idea that it could be cost-effective and democratized, you can't patent it, you can't monopolize it, it's a plant. And there's a reason it's called weed, right? It grows very robustly. You know, it doesn't need a lot of care. It's only getting orchid where you gotta, like, It just grows by the side of the road in many parts of the world. The idea that it might be safe, right? We see that statistically, less people die from cannabis, much less people die from cannabis than even die from over-the-counter drugs like Tylenol, ibuprofen. And the last part is the potential. We talked about a lot of potential use cases, right? And again, you're talking about one agent that could be used for different symptoms or different conditions, right? So that's find that very interesting. That sounds great. There's only one catch, though. And that's it's so incredibly difficult to do research on this. And that's because for the last 50 years, cannabis has been a Schedule I drug. Even to this day, it's a Schedule I drug. Highest potential for abuse, no medical use. So researchers have to go through inordinate barriers to be able to get approval to touch cannabis and give it to a mice or give it to a human. Not only that, we're blocked from federal funding. So if you want to do therapeutic research on cannabis, you're not going to get federal funding. So the federal government funds on the order of about $200 million a year of harm research into cannabis, pretty much close to zero for therapeutic research. Now amplify that over the last 50 years, $200 million a year. And so the only way that we can do this research is, I think philanthropy is going to be a large component of it. And, you know, and we are seeing philanthropists come onto the scene. So in Australia, there was a billionaire banker whose daughter was dying of seizures. He gave her CBD, it seemed to work, and he donated $30 million towards research. Largest gift ever for cannabis research. It was only about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago. So it's starting to come online. The philanthropists are starting to show up because we can't get really funding from anywhere else. These clinical trials are expensive, millions and millions and millions of dollars per clinical trial. And lastly, I'll just end by talking a bit about what we're building here at, building at UCLA. We're about 5 months in to the Cannabis Research Initiative, UCLA, one of the first programs in the world, first academic programs in the world focused on the study of cannabis. And our mission really is to broadly study the impacts on health, so both the positive aspects as well as the negative aspects. Right? We can't gloss over potential harms, especially as we are creating entirely new cannabis product categories that we don't know what they do. What does a 95% THC concentrate dabbed, what does that do to you? Right? We don't know. Our top priority that our research teams are working on right now is we want to conduct the world's first human study where we administer cannabis to chronic pain patients who are on opioids, to see if it could potentially reduce or eliminate their opioid use. Again, you see so much conversation about this issue, but no one's done the clinical trials to directly see what it can do to opioid use. But we're still very early on in the study. It's gonna take tons and tons of money and resources to actually pull this off. But it's one of our dreams right now is to pull off this study. You take a look at our website, some educational materials there. You can take a look at some of the existing studies we have going on. We have about 30 faculty members that I recruited into the initiative. And with that, that's the end of my talk. So thank you, everybody.
Science of cannabis, understanding kind of the global context that Brendan gave us.